Tonight's headlines are brought to you in part by Coldwell Energy and McDonald's.
Good evening, Commonwealth, and thanks for watching the Channel 2 News. I'm Sally Lemus. Let's take a look at tonight's top stories. Senators say there is a scandal up on Capitol Hill. Also tonight, one delay leads to another. Lack of prosecutor means lack of a pre-conference hearing. And enforcing cannabis may not be an easy job, but someone has to do it. In sports, motocross racer has big dreams for the tracks. Stay with us, we have these stories and more next.
Need a new phone? Trade in now and get up to $500 off our best 5G devices. Trade in your older phone in any condition and step up to better savings and speeds only our 5G network can provide. Check out our website and catch up on the best mobile experience. Trade in now. Docomo Pacific, better together.
There you have it. McDonald's new crispy chicken sandwich. From the makers of the world's most stolen fries. The juicy chicken sandwich from the place that offers extra napkins for a reason. The tender chicken sandwich from the creators of a sandwich phenomenon. So you won't just be biting into a chicken sandwich. You'll be biting into McDonald's new crispy, juicy, tender chicken sandwich. Ba-da-ba-ba-ba.
Half a day to the Wami and good evening, Commonwealth. Today is Friday, March 18, 2022. Every single detail of the impeachment process is being carefully looked at by both parties. One senator says there has been a breach of ethical conduct and is calling for an immediate investigation, while another senator sheds light on what really happened. Senator Paul Manglonia is calling for an immediate investigation, presenting evidence that the Senate special counsel and the governor's personal counsel may have worked together to draft, review, and edit the Senate's impeachment rules. In a letter to Senate President Jude Hofschneider, Manglonia provided screenshots of track changes made by Viola Alipuzu. The track changes shows that Alipuzu made 4 edits on page 15 to certain timelines within the rules. Senate Special Legal Counsel Joel McDulett applied the changes to the draft 3 days later. Manglonia states, quote, "This is a clear indication that the governor's personal counsel either drafted the Senate rules on behalf of Governor Torres or at the very least played a role in drafting, reviewing, and editing the rules," end quote. He goes on to say if this is really true, it would explain why the rules are weighed heavily in favor of the governor. Earlier this afternoon, Chairman Carl King Neighbors released a statement clarifying the issue. Quote, quote, "To set the record straight, Ms. Viola Alapuzzo, at my behest, recommended what would be an appropriate amount of time for certain responses. She made the edits, shortening the number of days for certain rules relating to when subpoenaed witnesses should respond for all parties," end quote. Neighbors elaborated on the fact that the edits by Alapuzzo were made on February 13 and her appointment to be the governor's personal counsel was made 5 days later. According to neighbors, there is no prohibition on ex parte communications at the federal levels, but the committee went ahead and included them in the rules. He says Senator Manglonia must have not read the rules or does not comprehend them. Neighbors states it's not uncommon for lawmakers to get outside input for legislations, and Manglonia just wants to make an issue of a non-issue. The chairman does not want to further delay the process and has even asked Alapuzzo to step down as the governor's attorney. Prior to the release, Governor Torres confirmed in an interview this morning that Alapuzzo is his personal counsel for the impeachment trial.
Can you just clarify, Viola Alapuzzo is your personal legal counsel in what kind of, is just only for the impeachment trial or for other matters as well?
No, just for the impeachment matter. There is no other matter.
The governor also refrained from answering any questions regarding the impeachment's proceedings this morning. Neighbors ends his statement with noting that those who are for the impeachment are finding every way to delay the process. The House of Representatives, along with Senator Manglonia, is looking for any reason. As of press time, KSPN has not received a comment back from Attorney Viola Alapuzzo in this matter. Alapuzzo also represented several government employees who were witnesses in the JGO hearings. Loosen the ties. House Speaker says the impeachment rules violates the Constitution and that they should have the choice to appoint the prosecutor. House Speaker Edmund Villagomez not only disapproves with the Senate rules, but he has rejected the position as impeachment prosecutor in the governor's trial. The committee had required Villagomez to make an appearance yesterday before 4 p.m. confirming the position. Villagomez did not appear and selected several members of the House to serve as the prosecutors instead.
I'm not disputing the fact that they have the authority to make the rules, but I think it's there's a constitutional issue when you really tie the hands of the House.
In a letter to Senate President Jude Hofschneider, Villagomez cited several violations of the CNMI Constitution.
In my letter, I did bring up that even on the federal side, when the Democrats were starting to take over and, there were issues with Trump and they had the impeachment with Trump, even with the Republican-controlled Senate, they still gave the Democrat-led House the opportunity to choose their managers. For the impeachment. So that's what it is.
Villagomez says the rules adopted by the Senate are also in violation of the Open Government Act.
Was the letter shared with all the nine members? Was it printed before the meeting? And then even when they had their session, for all we know, people wanted to come up and comment maybe on the rules or the proposed rules, but it was not there, and then later on they amended the agenda, which, and they included the rules, which may, there could be a violation of the Open Government Act. So a lot of these things, most especially regarding with how the rules are put together, are the issues, are the main reasons why I decline.
According to the Senate rules, the House Speaker shall serve as the impeachment prosecutor in the trial. If he declines, next in line to take the position is the chairperson of the House Impeachment Committee. This afternoon, Chairman Carl King Neighbors sent out another notice for Chairman BJ Attal to confirm the position no later than 4 p.m. on March 21st, Monday. If Attal does not accept the position, the Senate President then shall select a House member to serve as the impeachment prosecutor. More on the impeachment dilemma. One senator says family ties are blocking his ability to participate in the trial. Senator Justo Quitagua has informed the Senate that he will be recusing himself from participating and voting in the impeachment trial. In a letter addressed to the Senate President, Quitagua states he has a personal conflict of interest. Elaborating on the issue, Quitagua states that the governor's maternal grandfather is his mother's sibling. Noting that the impeachment hearing process is serious, Quitagua is avoiding a circumstance which compromises his ability to make an impartial judgment on any basis other than public good. The senator says he must abstain or recuse himself in order to maintain public confidence. The letter was sent out on March 8th, and to date there is no ready response from the Senate President. The CNMI is moving forward with the cannabis industry, holding trainings for police officers on how to enforce the herb. Police officers from the Department of Public Safety attended a training event this morning of the Cannabis Act law enforcement. Chief Prosecutor Chester Hines addressed several do's and don'ts when it comes to enforcing cannabis.
Well, we want it to flourish legally. So if it's flourishing legally, that means they can contribute to the economy, you know, et cetera. And more work now through training and education means less work later, less people being in trouble over marijuana. And also we want to focus on kids not smoking marijuana too. So that's why it's important that DPS understands where the line is.
According to cannabis law in the CNMI, a person under the age of 21 may not possess or purchase marijuana. Persons over the age of 21 are also not allowed to smoke marijuana in the presence of minors. This violation is taken seriously, along with the regulations for home growing. Hines states if an individual does not comply, the Attorney General's office may step in for prosecution.
We would be doing prosecution if there's excessive amounts being grown, for instance, if the person is in a category where we can say that maybe they're trafficking, you know, like you saw with the slide, unlawful delivery, you know, that kind of stuff. If a person is just selling a plant on stipend buy and sell, you know, we're not gonna arrest them, you know what I mean, or prosecute them. But if they're over the line, especially if they're growing at home and they're growing more than they should, we're gonna try and get them in compliance. We can confiscate their marijuana. I think it's important that people understand that. We're not going to prosecute unless there's a situation where we're seeing the danger of trafficking or like they're delivering it to children, you know, that kind of stuff.
Chief Prosecutor made it clear to get a license if you want to partake in marijuana consumption.
Get a license. Get a license. Contribute to the economy. Make sure that the marijuana industry flourishes legally. That's what we want.
Director of the Cannabis Commission, Monique Sablon, states training the frontliners is necessary to ensure safety to the community.
The relationship between the commission and law enforcement agencies, it's been a little bit of a gray area. A lot of us were not sure at one point of what was the relationship, who's enforcing what, who's going to enforce the businesses, who's enforcing, you know, marijuana out in the community. Now this training is to establish our relationship and what are our goals for this. And so we're starting off first with DPS, their frontliners and their supervisors. And really what we're trying to do is to give them the information, not through only for myself, but through legal advice.
Trainings began this week and will continue throughout the month. Custom officers and corrections officers will also have their own training. Governor Ralph Torres signed the Cannabis Act in 2019, providing an opportunity for revenue and leisure. The governor urges everyone, even government employees, to follow the rules.
We have this industry. Those that want to partake, please follow through the policies, laws, and those that please don't cut short on what this industry is providing the community. Again, to make it clear, this industry is as open, but at the same time, please follow our government rules and regulations. And if you're an employee of the government, you're still not supposed to be taking cannabis during your employment in the government.
Coming up, the North Side gets a major facelift, and probably not the good one. Stay tuned.
make you an offer you can't refuse. Bring your friends in for the best night out at Godfather's Bar in Garibin. Sing along to your favorite hits with live music from the Gigolos. Godfather's has daily food and drink specials, like Taco Tuesdays. The best pizza on island every day of the week. Located on Palm Street in Garibin, everybody is family at Godfather's Bar. Bada bing, bada boom.
Best gifts we can give ourselves is a healthy diet. Gold's Gym, our pre and post workout formula is loaded into every smoothie, giving you a satisfying meal with fewer calories. Perfect to enhance a workout or replace a meal, and you don't need to be a member to visit the Shake Cafe. This month, try our papaya banana medley for just $5.50, 380 calories of energy, 8 grams of fat, and 20 grams of protein. Fast food that is good for you and tastes great. Shake it up. Gold's Gym, Garibin.
Welcome back to the Channel 2 News. Trees, lots of trees coming down in front of the former Can Pacific property. CUC says the trees pose a danger to the power grid.
Timber! No, these trees aren't coming down because of the rhino beetle. These coconut trees have made the mistake of getting too tall, and the Commonwealth Utility Corporation is busy this week cutting down dozens of these trees that were planted here many, many years ago. Patrick Tagawa was overseeing the operation.
What's your team working on today?
So basically we're just cutting all vegetation underneath our power lines, and this happened to be our project site, our project area today. As you can see, we're cutting down coconut trees that are getting really close to our power lines, which has to be cut down. We're pretty much making our way all around the island and clearing any vegetation that's around and underneath the power lines.
What happens when a branch starts hitting one of those lines?
So when a branch touches the power line, basically power can flow through that branch all the way down to the ground, and it's very dangerous for somebody to come and just touch that branch. So, which is why we're trying to clear it. And also what we're doing here is to clear the vegetation so that we don't have any problems with power. You know, there's going to be no power outages, and people will just continue to have power.
The poles in this area are still the wooden ones. A lot of the poles that were put in after Typhoon Sutilor and Yutu were of the concrete variety. Here's what the power poles in the area looked like after Typhoon Sutilor, which hit the north hard and knocked power out to much of the grid. All through the northern area, power was out for about 3 months. Coconut trees are big ones. It's sad to see trees like this go down.
These guys are contract workers under ARPA. They're here to assist CUC, power division, on the line crew on clearing vegetation around the power poles and underneath the lines. So very thankful for that.
They get any specialized training to work in the area?
We do give them proper training before coming out to the field. Other than that, there's no specific training needed. It's just basically manpower.
And hard work, it looks like.
And hard work.
CUC says the expense of transplanting the mature trees was too much to consider.
If you weren't enough with the sneak peek we gave you on the Tinian Hot Pepper Festival, then it's your lucky day because we have more.
1, 2, 3. Welcome everyone, my name is Maurice. I'm going to take you to Tinian today. 10, 15 minutes in here. Let's leave that one open, please.
on the beautiful island of
Tinian and enjoy your stay.
The most that I love about Tinian, it's very hard to just say one. You know, the people in itself are very friendly. Everywhere you go, you know, they always greet you, you know, offer you food or drink.
Happy Pika Festival from Tinian.
Celebrating the hottest Doni Sali in the Northern Mariana Islands.
I love like the people. Where everyone's very close here in the island. Yeah. Get to celebrate the Doni Sali.
Pika, first thing that comes to mind is hot.
To everyone, let's enjoy Pika Festival. Congratulations to all the vendors for our continuing support and to the people of Tinian.
As Henry Ford once said, coming together is a beginning. Keeping together is progress. And working together is a success.
Tinian is truly a beautiful island. If you missed the Pika Festival this year, you can catch it next year. All right, folks, don't go anywhere because we have sports up next.
You are everything that matters to me, and I promise to do whatever it takes to keep you healthy, to be comfortable, and to be free. I love you. As long as we're together, I'll always make sure that home will always be our best place to breathe.
The Tan Sri Lin Foundation promotes the culture of giving back. The foundation and its generous partners are committed to supporting programs that include health, education, and sports. Initiatives that promote arts and culture, the environment, and tourism will benefit our community and our residents. Giving back and making a difference will help ensure that the island paradise we call home will be a better place to live.
At one of Saipan's beaches, this mother lays about 100 eggs under the cover of darkness. She hides her nest as best she can and then slowly makes her way back to the ocean. The eggs hatch and the babies head for the sea where they will face a daily dose of danger. Just 1 in 1,000 will make it to adulthood. Those that do will one day lay their own eggs. Sea turtles are protected under CNMI law. If you see one that is stranded or if you see illegal activity, call the hotline at 287-8537.
Hey,
Hey, golfers, come north and practice your game at the Marianas Driving Range. New Year's local specials. 10-piece coupon books available for just $60. That's a $10 savings. Want to get really good? Come work on your swing every day for just $99 per month. It's our practice pass, and you're going to love it. Grab your passes and go straight to the range. You can social distance and chip all at the same time, and the views are free. Reserve now at marianastrekking.com. You can pay online, open 7 days a week.
Need a new phone? Trade in now and get up to $500 off our best 5G devices. Trade in your older phone in any condition and step up to better savings and speeds only our 5G network can provide. Check out our website and catch up on the best mobile experience. Trade in now. Docomo Pacific, better together.
Tonight, sports brought to you in part by TAN Holdings through the Tan Soo Lin Foundation, making communities a better place to live.
Buenas sports fans.
And for the KSPN Sports Report, the Northern Marianas Beach volleyball training continues as athletes gear up for the mini games.
National team practice currently being held three times a week at Micro Beach. The NMI is hosting the mini games this summer. Some major improvements are on the way as the beach is in front of Crown Plaza, formerly known as the Fiesta, as well as the Hyatt, are currently being renovated. This volleyball post is not going to move much. It's encased in a drum filled with concrete and was recently moved due to storm damage. Hyatt Beach has gotten smaller the last couple of years, and the plan is to accommodate up to 6 courts in front of Crown Plaza. NMI will field one team from the men's side and one from the women's. Countries that are planning to send beach teams include nearby Guam and Palau, as well as Fiji, Samoa, Tahiti, New Caledonia, Papua New Guinea, and more. Tice Mister is the head coach for both the men's and the women.
Today's a little wet and sloppy, but these guys are out here and they're working pretty fast and hard and getting sandy. It's fun.
What do you work on a rainy day? What sort of skills are you working on today?
Well, today we're working on attacking, just really knowing where to put the shot with some control, and working on some defense today too.
All right, how about the ladies?
Ladies are over here. Good showing today, so we have, right now we're just wrapping up with a little 4-on-4.
Nice set here from Jacoby Winkfield and a cut shot from Jermaine.
And angle. Woohoo! Nice shot, Jermaine.
The ladies are playing 4-on-4 here and working on cut shots and defense. Coach Mister wants passes and sets to be a little bit higher. Tomorrow, a tournament will be held down here at the beach called For the Luck of Volleyball in a nod to St. Patrick's Day. 14 men's teams are registered and 5 ladies' teams for the one-day tournament.
Tonight, we introduce a young, motivated motocross racer who wishes to make it to the pros. It is not the size of a man, but the size of his heart that matters. A quote by Evander Holyfield.
Young Star Shining, brought to you by the Tan Soo Lin Foundation.
Our young star for tonight is a very young motocross superstar. He's only 11 years old, a fifth grader from Garapan Elementary School, and his name is TJ Ferrer.
I'm Kristen Jacob Ferrer, and I'm 11 years old. I go to Garapan Elementary School, and I'm in fifth grade.
Ferrer joined the motocross a little over a year ago. It was his father, Bob, who is a motocross enthusiast himself, that got him into the sport.
My dad and most likely my mom for buying the bike.
What kind of bike do you have?
I have a YZ85 right now.
Oh, nice.
I started off with a PW80 and they're both from Yamaha.
He plays soccer and basketball once in a while, but doing the motocross is what he loves the most.
The feeling and just riding in general.
He has participated in several motocross races and he wants to improve some technical moves, especially his jumping.
Definitely not be scared jumping because when me and my dad were last there training, we were working on jumps and I was so scared of hitting that double.
What's the highest that you've jumped so far?
Probably like 35 feet.
Ferrer won the third place for the Pee Wee Class 2 during the 2021 Monster Energy Point Series race in Marpy last summer. This is his biggest achievement so far in this field of the sport.
Getting that third place on the podium for points in the Pee Wee 2 class.
Last month, he also joined the Marianas Racing Association Round 2 races, and he considers it as one of his best races.
Last February, I won Heat 1, and then Heat 2 of that race, I got second.
Nice.
So that's by far the best race I had.
Ferrer looks up to his idol, Ellie Tomac, and he wants to be a professional motocross racer someday like him.
Yes, I want to make this into a career, go into professional racing, become like my idol, Eli Tomac.
Here is his piece of advice to the young generation who are into the motocross racing.
Don't give up and certainly just keep trying. And motocross racing is really fun. You should go try it. Come to Kaotan and have fun.
Young Star Shining, brought to you by the Tan Soo Lin Foundation.
Buy one, get one free for the off-road adventure at Marianas Trekking. Come ride our side-by-sides at our best price ever and experience a great 90-minute trail ride. Rain or shine, hopefully rain. Book now at Marianas Trekking. Saturdays and Sundays by reservation. Call 323-8735 or book at marianastrekking.com.
Hi, I'm Dre, one of the personal trainers here at Gold's Gym, and today we're going to go over the cable lat pulldown. Now what we want to remember with machine-based exercises, there's really no right or wrong way of doing it. There's multiple ways of executing the exercise. What you'll often see is lifters executing the exercise in this fashion, and instead of working the muscles of your upper back, you're just irritating the shoulder joint, which is what you don't want. All right, let's clean that up a little bit. Let's sit upright a little bit more. Okay, as you get a full stretch, bring it down with your elbows coming in. So in general, as you set up this way, you're going to be feeling majority of the impulse right here, which is your lats. Okay. He's getting a full stretch and he's getting a full squeeze in the bottom.
And for the KSPN weather report, partly sunny with isolated showers, east wind 16 to 18 miles per hour with gusts up to 25 miles per hour. Tonight, it's partly cloudy with isolated showers, east wind 9 to 17 miles per hour with gusts as high as 23 miles per hour. High 86, a low 77, a 79% humidity. Tomorrow, mostly sunny with isolated showers, east wind 9 to 14 miles per hour. High 86, a low 76. The marine forecast, moderate fresh trade winds will decrease to moderate on Saturday. Combined seas of 4 to 6 feet will decrease to 3 to 5 feet on Saturday again. Sunrise will be at 6:22 a.m., high tide at 8:14 a.m., the low tide at 1:50 a.m., and the sunset will be at 6:27 p.m. All right, there you have it, CNMI. That is your Friday edition of the new sports and weather. We thank you so much for watching. We wish that you have a happy, happy weekend, and we'll see you back here on Monday.